With a bit of class, this is BBC Two.
For the past 32 programmes, you've watched us test virtually every new car on the market today. From the fast to the slow, from the big to the small, from the extraordinarily exciting to the Vauxhall.
Well, this is the last Top Gear of the current series, and as a special treat for you, we've come up with something, well, call it an end-of-term party.
Because tonight, it's no holds barred. We're going to be redefining extravagance and showing you what life could be like if money were no object.
What sort of hooligan is at the controls?
Sorry, everyone. Bit of a crosswind. Look, does anyone know where the handbrake is?
Also on the conveyor belt tonight, TVR's new Tuscan, a monster from Mercedes, and an aristocratic Aston.
Doors to manual.
God, it's always the same. Getting on an airfield and it's all screeching brakes and smoking tyres.
Never mind that. Look at the rental car they've left us. A Rolls-Royce Corniche convertible. All £250,000, including local tax.
More of this later, but first, Tiff's off to drive something a little more energetic.
It's been with us for 24 years. Its power has grown from 260 bhp to over 400. It's put on nearly half a ton in weight. It's the Porsche everyone talks about. The 911 Turbo. A jolly good time. There hasn't been one on sale since the new shape was launched in 1997. And, as always, it's the version that Porsche love to keep you waiting for.
But now, it's here. And for the first time, it's moved into the modern world. The detuned version of the water-cooled 3.6-litre twin-turbo that powered Porsche to victory at Le Mans in 1998. It produces 420 horsepower and will propel this 911 to 189 miles an hour, at which speed is surprisingly stable. That impressive high-speed stability is thanks to ever-improving aerodynamics, with the airflow both over and under the car, creating downforce which helps stick the car into the road. Well, most of the time, anyway. This latest turbo only has a little bit more power and a little bit more torque than the previous version. But what it does have is Porsche's very latest VarioCam engine management system, which constantly and seamlessly alters the nature of the engine throughout the rev range, unlike Honda's VTEC system, which is much more like an on-off switch.
With only 100 turbos coming to Britain each year and over 200 deposits already on them, there's a long waiting list, and those lucky few have been given an early Christmas present, as Porsche have just dropped the price from £97,000 down to £86,000, and that's six less than the previous model.
The turbo sits just one inch lower than this standard 911, yet sets itself apart with a deep front air dam that snarls out from under its own trademark headlamps. And of course, at the rear, there's a wing, which this time only goes up when the car reaches 75 miles an hour. So you won't be seeing any of those on British roads, will you?
You can now even have an automatic Tiptronic gearbox with your turbo. But when that VarioCam system allows you to pull cleanly from 20 miles an hour to 190 miles an hour in six, why bother?
The four-wheel drive powertrain varies from 95% to the rear normally, down to 60 when things get a little bit on the wild side. But what that means is that the predominant handling characteristic is understeer, 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 which, as you know, isn't my favourite, but it is the safest when you've got this sort of power going through those wheels. But this 911 isn't so much about handling, it's more about grip, grip, and more grip, because you can plant that 420 horsepower on the road and go around this Millbrook Alpine test circuit at speeds I'd never previously dreamt of. This is one hell of a road car. They may only come along once in every 8 years, but the 911 Turbo is always worth waiting for.
Very well, but if they're a bit new money for your tastes, you might want to consider something more blue-blooded, a true thoroughbred that discreetly oozes class, distinction, and most importantly, breeding. And odds-on favourite to get the Palmer Tomkinson posse gushing all over the Sunday supplements is this, the Aston Martin DB7 Vantage Volante. Aston have beefed up their fun in the sun appeal with this soft-top version. And because it's Aston, each and every one is built to the customer's exact specifications. The looks are stunning, and so is what's under the bonnet. Owners Ford have helped develop its new, cleaner 6-litre V12 engine that houses a royal parade of 420 horses, all of them champing at the bit. Tally ho! Luckily, you don't have to perch above a tiny scrap of leather with your bum in the air when you're riding Newport Pagnell's thoroughbred. Instead, you're cushioned by acres of soft hide with only the merest hint of Big Brother Ford in one or two of these plastic switches. And if you find changing with a stick tiresome, you can now ask Aston to put a little man under the bonnet to do it for you. Prod the information in through here, and for a mere £4,000 above the basic £100,000, you get a slick, effortless result. And while we're talking numbers, how about these? 0 to 60 in under 5 seconds, maxing out at an awesome 185 miles per hour. So as soul stirrers go, driving this is up there with winning the Cheltenham Gold Cup. But then again, what's the hurry? Just sit back and enjoy it and don't feel intimidated by the supercar statistics, because the Vantage is more than happy to keep it extremely civilised.
You don't have to build up a sweat when attempting a tight manoeuvre or when you're trundling along with lesser mortals in the traffic. It feels amazingly pliable at slow speeds, a miracle when you consider that there's 18 inches of Bridgestone's finest propping up each corner.
And there's so much torque that when you're driving around town, there's really no need to take it out of third gear, which of course gives people more of a chance to get a good butcher's at your super, super car. But beware the nasty side effects.
Yes, Aston Martin's touch the parts that others just don't reach. And so it's on this evidence that I really must advise you to bow down to materialism. Sell your house, outhouse, stables and precious antiques, because the DB7's powers of seduction are simply too strong to resist. But there's just one thing that's troubling me.
Somehow I feel that someone else should be sitting here, and I should be sitting over here, because what one really needs is a chauffeur.
So if you've ever wondered what it takes to be a Rolls-Royce and Bentley chauffeur, stay with us, because I'm going to do a week course crashed into one day. But first, I'm told I have to wear this, because as usual, I'm improperly dressed.
Lesson one, maintenance. Rolls-Royces and Bentleys never break down, they just fail to proceed. But occasionally, 200 quid's worth of tyre may pick up a nail left for the working classes. A good chauffeur should do the change in 7 minutes. Sir must never be kept waiting.
Now, it's very, very important to make sure that
It's facing the same way up as all the others.
You should also be able to change a bulb in 2 minutes flat. Sir must never be pulled by plod. Second lesson, washing. You use 3 buckets, one for the roof, one for the sides, and one for the mucky bits at the bottom. Drop your sponge and you throw it away, because a good chauffeur never, ever rubs grit into those lustrous flakes.
And then there's etiquette. There's more to opening and closing a Bentley door than you ever dared imagine.
Now, what if they are struggling? Do I give them my hand?
No, that's too personal. What we do then, we just offer your arm. So you turn around, brace yourself with the door, offer your arm, but look over there.
Switch hand round, offer arm, but look other way. This isn't chauffeuring, this is a black art.
So that the fascia runs around about just behind your knuckles, yeah?
This is what's known as in-car deportment.
Yeah, your hands nicely at 10 to 2, so this one just slightly lower. Yeah, that's it. And your thumbs just wrapped inside the wheel. That's fine. If you've got a lady passenger in the front seat, really, we want to ignore this mirror, because we're going to be looking at the mirror, legs, road, road, legs, mirror. This one, we position it so that we can see the vehicles behind, but again, trying to avoid eye contact with any passengers in the rear.
My fourth lesson, driving, and about time.
We're looking for any bumps and potholes, thinking about the people in the back, thinking about a nice smooth ride for those.
And what if Sir in the back says, come on James, we need to press on a bit, I'm late.
Well, we can actually make him feel like he's going quicker by not being as smooth with the steering. We could press the brake pedal a little harder, just press the gas pedal a little harder, things like that, little tricks that when he's sat in the back there reading his book or his paper, he thinks he's going quickly, but we're still staying well within the constraints of the law.
So it's a bit of a scam.
A little one.
My sixth lesson, defensive driving, was easy. I do it all the time. But the seventh, threading between poles, wasn't. Apparently, when it comes to driving slowly, I'm hopeless. A little too close on the port side there. 6 o'clock, and it's time for my result.
So, results time, Steve. How did I do?
And it gives me great pleasure to award you with this. Well done.
Look, everybody. Distinction.
And what better way to celebrate that distinction than with a gentle drive in our Corniche? Although to really explore its performance, we need the help of a certain colleague. Because in the right hands, the 325 brake turbo V8, electronic ride control and intelligent auto gearbox turn the Corniche into a bit of a sports car. How does he do it?
According to Quentin, you must be sensible when buying at auction. You must never pay over the odds and you must never let emotions get in the way of your purchase. Those tips won't come in very handy at this auction because sensible is not an option and money is no object. Because this is no rough-and-ready second-hand car sale, and the punters are hardly typical. Because this is a Coy's auction, and it's where the very rich come to buy very expensive cars, though some they might not even drive. But these are no ordinary motors. There's something special about every one. They are some of the greatest cars ever made, icons of motoring history, works of art rather than mere transport, and they date back to the earliest days of the automobile. This 1912 Rolls-Royce Silver Ghost is expected to be one of the top earners, fetching anything up to £120,000. It is the car that established Rolls as the rich man's manufacturer, and this particular car has spent most of its life in Australia and New Zealand, and I think it is absolutely fantastic, and I'm very keen to honk its big horn.
Or if you want something a bit more modern, this rare Aston DB5 convertible could fit the bill. And of course, there are also Ferraris and Jaguars. Or if you've got the odd 100 grand to spend,
In 1955, this 215 brake Mercedes-Benz Gullwing was one of the fastest touring cars of its day. It was ready to race straight out of the box, and it successfully competed in the Mille Miglia and the Tour de France. And I think it's the most stunning car Mercedes has ever built.
But enough of the cars. What about the people who buy them?
We did sit in it, and as soon as you push the gear stick and realise how hard it is on your shoulder, you might think twice. However, I could just park it outside the house. That would be nice.
I've got a 2025, but it's in about 1,000 pieces at the moment, so I feel a bit sort of unhorsed. I need something else to drive around in.
Well there's a gurney nutting, three position, drop head, lot 77.
The only difference in a man and a boy is the price of his toys, and I think we're into the toys in a big way.
Yeah. Hello. Ah, Ferrari. Now, let's see how much that is. 95 to 110 grand. I could sell my Tiff Nadal memorabilia. No, wouldn't fetch much. The Quentin Wilson portrait. Perfect.
£100,000 here at the back of the room.
The auction raised a cool £1.5 million, with money coming in from all over the world.
At £102,000 then for the first. For the second?
But as for me, well, I never got a bid in.
They wouldn't even give me tuppence for Quentin's portrait, so the Ferrari was a non-starter. Still, there's plenty of rich young men around.
Me.
You'll be pleased to know I have given my chauffeur his P45. Tiff just has no sense of occasion. So instead of telling you about the world's most glamorous soft top at a frenzied Derby gallop, let's do it at a more measured, genteel pace. Hey, I
saved the world today. It takes 35 craftsmen 40 days to build the quarter of a £1 million Corniche. And Rolls reckon they know 75% of its likely customers by name already. A third will be bought by women, and owners will have, on average, between 6 and 9 other cars, slightly up on the norm.
Despite its titanic weight, girth, cost, and appetites, the Corniche is surprisingly disarming to drive. It's not slow. That fantastic 6.75 V8 that first saw the light of day in 1959 propels this car towards the horizon at really quite surprising speeds. Hugely undignified, of course, but enormous and very expensive fun. But the question I've been hiding from all day has come to find me. Is the Rolls-Royce Corniche vulgar? Probably, but it's all a question of context. Driving round the genteel suburbs of Gloucestershire, you could hardly say it blends in with the architectural vernacular. But put this in Palm Springs, and suddenly you have a corner of a foreign field that is forever England. I'm tempted at this point, purely out of habit, you understand, to reel off a set of numbers, 0-60, top speed, miles per gallon, but somehow it just doesn't seem appropriate. Let's leave the numbers to another day. Let's just sit back, relax, and bask.
Bask in what could well be the last chance for aficionados to acquire a crew-built roller before BMW take over. I'm sorely tempted, but I just don't think a man like me could live with those running costs.
And since English Heritage are unlikely to give me a grant to pay for a new roof, I'm going to be forced to open this particular stately home to the public. Tiff, remember, no discount for children.
Sorry, sir. That'll be nicely.
Morning.
Ladies and gentlemen.
Morning. Enjoy your day.
This is it.
And I'm watching you, Sonny.
And of course, this is the actual seat that Mr. Wilson sits in. Uh-huh.
Now, you've picked the right day to come, because when the aerial's up, it means that Mr. Wilson is in residence, so you might get a peek at the man himself.
Ladies and gentlemen, just to remind you that the daily changing of the sump guard will be happening at 4 o'clock, which is in about 15 minutes' time. Thank you.
We have a unique line in commemorative plates and tea sets, limited signed editions of Mr. Wilson's new book, A Man of Many Roles. Interesting.
Soon we'll have sold enough souvenirs to pay for the new guttering.
As awe-inspiring as the Rolls-Royce is, its £250,000 price tag is a bit on the obscene side. And you don't have to bank at Fort Knox to buy into some British-built eccentricity. Because TVR have been doing it for years, and this is their latest northern star, the Tuscan Speed 6. It may not have TVR's classic R8 V8, but the Tuscan still makes an awesome sound. Each blip of the throttle sends a tarmac-shivering clue as to what's available when your right foot hits the floor. And as any physician will tell you, when 1,100 kilograms are propelled by 380 horsepower, the results are always going to be impressive. 60 comes in a shade over 4 seconds, with a promised top speed of 180 miles an hour. But retire to the serenity of the British B Road, and you soon find out that the Tuscan isn't just a straight-line speed freak. At first, the steering appears to be too quick. But it's not, it's just that the TVR has superb steering reaction. The front goes exactly where you point it, and the rear, hopefully, follows sometime later. The ride is firm but supple, while the power assistance to the steering doesn't smother the experience. It's still got a nice weighty feel. The gear change requires hefty handiwork. And no, I've not been driving two different cars. It's the £2,000 paint job that makes Jekyll meet Hyde. Who meets Jekyll? Who meets Hyde? But no matter how you look at this Targa-topped Tuscan, it's a case of beauty clashing with the brutishness of TVR's own 4-litre straight six. And that innovative beauty is carried through to the glorious cabin. Whereas the innards of most modern-day sports cars deserve to be recycled every couple of years, the Tuscan's has the kind of creativity only found in a modern-day arts museum. The TVR doesn't have dials and switches, it has toys, like these air vents that shoot out at you from an aluminium dashboard, like these tactile little brass knurled knobs, and buttons on the dash that turn on hazard lights. It's wonderful. But while the auxiliary switches may be works of art, the heart of the dashboard is the very latest high-tech LCD display, complete with gear change lights.
This is the house that Funk built.
Oh yes, and if, like me, you don't like the green sweets, you can simply make them disappear. This latest version of the great British sports car is absolutely perfect for enjoying great British weather. With money being no object, I think that I'll keep the Porsche 911 Turbo for everyday use and a little Tuscan for the weekends.
It's been so much fun, I want to do it all over again.
Oh, this party got it going. Oh!
Sports cars are all very well and good, but these days you don't buy cars on patriotic reasons, you buy them for practical reasons, like a Mercedes-Benz, like this CL500. Now here's the thing, it's a coupe, yet it's hugely practical. Look at this boot, it is the size of Banbury.
No, Victoria?
Oh,
all series, he's gone on and on about Mercs, and it's time someone else had a go. May I introduce you to the Mercedes-Benz 500 CL?
Victoria?
It's a coupe based on Quentin's favourite, the S-Class, and it's the flagship model to the whole Mercedes-Benz range. It's bought by the wealthiest of the wealthy. People who want all the qualities from the S-Class, presence, solidity and luxury, but wrapped up in a more sporting skin.
Victoria! Victoria! Actually, it's actually rather good in here. I've got a first aid kit, I've got a little interior light, air conditioning vents, and of course it is fully carpeted.
Did you hear something? I'm usually of the opinion that a Mercedes is no place for a nice young girl like myself. They're for fat-bottomed businessmen with more share options and sense. But you know, I think I've been missing out. I could so get used to all this pampering. The seats are comfy enough for my front room, and everywhere you look, there's the finest leather and wood. And in case you get a little too relaxed in here, there are millions of gadgets and gizmos to keep you amused. So the view from the inside is pretty good. However, the view from the outside is a completely different matter. In making a coupe, Mercedes has given this the new family front end. They've taken away two doors and they've dropped in a boomerang roofline. Some say it looks sleek and elegant, others that it looks like a barge. Me, I agree with the latter. I think it looks more at home on a canal. So exactly how much is a CL going to set back your shareholders? Well, there's a 5-litre V8 for £71,000, or there's a 6-litre V12, which is a tiny bit quicker and costs an extra £21,000, but it's still not perfect. Because this Uber Cruiser is ideal for blitzing the Autobahn, but not much else. The steering feel is just too nondescript. What is notable is Mercedes' new active body control system. A computer constantly monitors whether you're accelerating, braking or cornering. That computer controls a clever hydraulic system that makes sure the car will always ride impeccably. As well as making for sportier handling, that greater suspension control means that any sort of evasive manoeuvre can be dealt with much more safely. And therein lies the point. I know you're probably sitting at home thinking these mega money motors are irrelevant, but they are important to us all because they're test beds for cutting edge technology. And sooner or later, that will percolate down to everyday cars, which will benefit every one of us. And let's not forget that it's not just Mercedes who are giving us that technology. Is it, Quentin?
I know. I apologise unreservedly, Victoria, I'm very sorry. Could I have another go in the boot, do you think?
Well, I hope you enjoyed our look at the high life. Over £1 million worth of machinery in less than half an hour. Top Gear's back on air in September, and we're all off on our summer holidays.
Ah, but due to the unique way the BBC is funded, we'll be travelling on these.
The fastest growing form of transport in the UK.
Ah, yes, Victoria, but they're not made by Mercedes.
Good night.
Well, he's gone from Top Gear, but he's not forgotten. And in fact, he's back in his own series, Jeremy Clarkson. Who else? Details in a moment.
It takes 35 craftsmen, 40 working days to build... Whose telephone is that? Whose mobile telephone is that? It's mine. Morning.